Okay, hello everyone. After a short break, I would like to introduce you Mr. Adam Zambrocki, and he will talk about Crash Dumps Hunt, Zero Days and Rootkits. Okay, the floor is yours.
Okay. So, hello everyone. I'm happy to see so many people here. My name is Adam Zabrocki, and I will try to find interesting my presentation. If you want contact with me, you can always ping me by mail, official one, adamza@microsoft.com, and you can always use private one, which is p3@p3.com.pl. I also have got my private website, which is p3.com.pl, where you can always find some actual mail which you can ping me to contact with me, and also sometimes I put some my research. But in the last time, I do not have so much time, so it's not updated often. So what is the topic of my presentation? Is crash dumps, hunt zero days and rootkits. It sounds quite sexy, at least for me. And also at the same time a bit mysterious. So, but what is hidden behind this topic? If you didn't read the abstract, probably you can overestimate my presentation, because I'm not going to talk about some hardcore unknown techniques about root code analysis or I don't know any kind of the zero days hunting, which is unknown in other words. It's not the goal of this topic. So, what is the goal, in fact? So I would like to show a different approach for the crash dumps. Crash dumps is the source of very interesting information, especially for the administrator, NetSec guys, networking guys in general, or about status of the network. In fact, it's not only about that, but this is the main goal. But before I go forward, I would like to say two sentences about myself. In fact, I'm forced to do it. So my name is Adam Zabrocki. Sometimes I'm using P3, but also some others which I'm not going to mention here. And among others, I was working in the European Organization for Nuclear Research, known as CERN, also in the HispaSec, known from the virus total, the Wrocław Center of Networking Supercomputing, CIGITAL. In fact, a bit more, it doesn't matter. In my free time, I'm doing a bug hunting. I found vulnerabilities, among others, OpenSSH, Apache, XPDF, Adobe Reader, and more. And I've got CV numbers for that. In my free time, I'm doing also research about exploitation, and one of my research was published in the FRAC about bypassing modern mitigation, memory safety. And also I was part of the RSI project, and I was a developer for the MIPS infrastructure. Now I'm working at Microsoft. I start my journey with the science team. Now I'm in the detection and defense. So at first I want to show you the table of contents of my presentation, so show the roadmap. So some of you maybe would like to choose go and see nice sun today, not stay in the cave. So at first I would like to answer the question, why crash dumps? Why I chose the crash dumps to achieve the goals which I said at the beginning? Why exactly this source of information? Second, I would like to talk a bit about exploitation trends, because it's very connected with the crash dumps itself. And in this case, I would like to show you some plots about modern exploitation trends. I also want to focus a bit and make some sentence about rootkits itself and malware. So is it possible to get any information which can be useful about the status of the network from the crash dumps in the goal of the rootkits? Is it possible, in fact, to monitor rootkits in the network from the crash dumps? Or is it possible in general? And also, all of this talk makes sense only when we have the crash dumps, yes? So the important question is how to collect this data, especially in the big networks. And also, I would like to show you some statistics almost in the end, because I want to prove you that this is not just a stupid theory and works pretty well. So I make some simple statistics. In the end, maybe we'll have time for quick questions or discussions. Or maybe instead of questions and discussions, I've got my project, which I was developing for more than 7 months in the Microsoft. I'm the owner of this project, which is doing everything automatically. And maybe I will have time to show you that. We'll see. So, okay, let's start. I believe that most of you here know what is a crash dump itself, but I want to summarize anyway that for the people who is not familiar with this topic, that also has some knowledge. So in most of the time, I will focus on the Windows operation system, but the idea is independent from the operation system, so it doesn't matter which system is it. And I maybe say 2 sentences about other systems also. So the crash dumps is a file generated by the operation system at the time when the specific event appears, for example, application or operation system crashes. And this file, at first place, it's supposed to help developers to figure out what is going on. So in very high level, we can divide the crash dumps for the kernel mode dump files and user mode dump files. In the Windows operation system, kernel mode dump files, we've got 3 different types of crash dumps. For kernel mode, it's a complete memory dump. Kernel memory dump is small memory dump. Complete memory dump file is the largest kernel mode dump file which can be generated in any time. It includes whole physical memory that is used by the Windows. But this complete memory dump will not include these physical pages, which is used by the platform's firmware. So excluding platform's firmware, whole physical memory is there. That's the reason the dump file is really, really big. The kernel memory dump file contains all of the memory which is used in the kernel at the time when the crash appears. So this dump file, of course, will not include the memory which is not allocated, so it's unallocated memory, or any memory which is used by the user space. Application, but it includes all of the memory which is used currently by Windows kernel and hardware abstraction layer known as HAL. And also, this will include the memory which is used by device drivers and any kernel mode processor threads. And also, we've got small memory dump file, which is quite funny because it includes this kind of information, maybe to save time, because my presentation is too long for this period of the time. I will not focus on that in the details. But what is interesting, that this small memory dump file is always only 64 kilobytes in size. It's never exceed this size. That's the reason if there is an information about the stack trace, it's only 60 kilobytes. It cannot be more, because they do not, they can't, in fact, exceed the 64 kilobytes in size. So it requires only the 64 kilobytes page file space on the boot drive to be generated. From the Windows XP and later, we also has got this kind of information. So what is important, we've got list of the loaded and unloaded modules, which was used by the kernel, also the debugger data block. But what is also very important, and it's funny, because it includes any additional data, memory pages, that Windows identifies as useful in the debugging. So the question is how it identifies what is useful, what is not. It's quite also interesting how they did it in the Windows, because if there is any memory which is referenced by the registers or by the stack, for Windows, it's interesting, so it also will be included. So it's quite important. About the user mode dump files, in the very high level, we've got full user mode dump file and mini dump file. Full user mode dump file will include the whole user space memory, including the images itself, and also any dependent library. And the mini dumps, it's also interesting because size of the mini dumps and the content of the mini dumps is very depends on the application, which is being dumped, and application which is doing that dump file. That's the reason it's completely random what can be there. It can be, at one point, even more information than the full memory dump file includes. In other case, it can only has information about the single thread with crash, nothing else. And because of that, mini dump name of the mini dump is somehow misleading, because the largest mini dump file has more information than the full user mode dump file. Of course, different operation system has got different types of crash dumps. For example, Linux kernel, they have lacks of this capability for the very long time. It's not true anymore. But up to version 2.6 to 13, the Linux kernel didn't generate any crash dumps for the kernel. So the question is why they did it. There is 2 possible reasons. First of all, Linux kernel never crashes. Of course, it's not true. Obviously, it crashes as in other systems. But second option is the kernel developers, they didn't want to have these crash dumps. They didn't care about that. But what is important, that the Linux kernel, Linux vendors, they do want to have crash dumps because they want to better support their clients. That's the reason there was different projects over the time which was written to exactly achieve this goal. The most popular are exactly these 4. I do really like all of them. And what is exactly interesting, that KeyDump was a project divided into 2 parts, there is a kernel mode part and user mode part, and the kernel mode part now is merged as to the mainline kernel tree from the version 2.6.13. I personally do very like disk dump, but we don't have time to analyze it. And what I also met in my work, it was, for example, commercial last system. It has got different operation system in many times, and also they generate different crash dumps files. And I found one of the NAS system which was zeroing this memory where it could be a client's data. The reason why they did it, because this NAS system was widely used in the banking, especially investment banks, and these guys are really scary about leaking any kind of the data in any form, so whenever the crash dump appears, they on the fly zeroing this memory which could be a client's data. There was only one exception when this current chunk was involved for generating a crash, it would include, in this case it was 4 kilobytes. So, okay, now we know what is a crash dumps, we know what kind of information are inside, but what we can do with that? How we can get any information about the network from the crash dumps? And it's interesting, because if you monitor the internet or huge networks, probably tens, hundreds, or even thousands of crash dumps are generated per day. And this, of course, depends how big network is. This is some kind of normal situation. It maybe sounds quite crazy, but it is. But at one point, if you see that there is significant rise of the frequency of generating a crash dumps, usually something bad happened. So if per day you monitor your network, you've got hundreds of crash dumps, but at one point you see there is thousands of them, it's not normal situation, it's very abnormal, let's say. And the goal is, what is going on there? There is many situations what can happen. One of them, that's exactly network, our network is under attack, and the crash dumps are generating because of that. It's not always like that, because it can also happen that some updates can kill the integrity of our network, and even update can cause this situation. So the goal is how we can know what is going on exactly at this time when we see this peak time of increasing the frequency of generation of crash dumps. So what we can do, we can find an evidence of attack in the crash dumps which was generated in the time when this peak time was observed. How to do it? So let's discuss a very simple situation with the minimal information in the mini dump, which is default by the Windows operation system. It will include exactly this piece of the information. Again, it's not much, because all of this information, in fact, could be just a text file. We'll have a stack trace, caching instruction, register value, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's not much. We don't even have a memory. It's just simple basic information. So what we can do with this if we just seize it? So in fact, let's discuss at first these four blocks, stack trace, caching model, version of caching model, and offsetting caching model. But there is also something which I didn't mention, and everyone has got access for that. It's not in the crash dumps, but everyone has got it. It's a public symbols. Public symbols, it's the, let's say, benefits from the Microsoft itself. It's very useful, because if you connect the crashing module with the offset in crashing module with the public symbols, in most of the cases, we'll have the function name. So we have the function in the module which crashes. So if we connect the next two blocks, like a version of crashing module and stack trace with the function name, in most of the cases, we can identify if there is any known MSRC case for this vulnerability function, if it was, of course, vulnerability. So let's say we found the module, we found the version, so we can check in the MS bulletin if there is any kind of reported vulnerability for this specific function, for this specific module. It's starting to be quite interesting, because if you then look closer for these two blocks, crashing instruction and registers value, we can try to find unusual values there. For example, known memory spraying attack addresses. One of the very famous addresses, 41414141, it's typically used in the pods. So if you see these kind of values in the registers, it's quite not normal, or some memory spraying address values like 0C, 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 0D, 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 0D. If you see it, it's starting to be quite strange, especially if you also identify the MSRC case, possible MSRC case, to this function. If we then look closer to the exception record, it's a very interesting piece of the information, because we are able to determine the type of the exception, which could be, for example, AV, access violation on the read or write, or DEP. And the second one is it's in fact something which we do not want to see. because it can happen that when exploit successfully spray the memory, but because of the DEP, execution failed. This means in 100%, if the type of the exception was DEP, that the crash was generated by the exploit attack. Now it's analyzing done, we don't need anymore, just because of that. But okay, also we've got two other blocks of information, which is the name of the crashing application and version of crashing application. Now, if we, what we can do with these two blocks, we can connect all of the previous analyze with two of them, and then we can have a targeted application and attack, for example, which was done for this application. Nowadays, it's very common that there is some specific application which is always under attack, like, for example, Flash Player, Java, or browsers. So if we identified in the model which crashed MSRC case, we found unusual values, we found access violation on write, and everything can happen in Flash or some Internet Explorer browser, for example, it's not awesome, let's say. But okay, everything from the previous analysis was just a speculation, because it's just a small mini dump file. But it's in fact very unconvincing. So what about the full memory dump file? If you of course have it, of course obviously it's much more powerful, and we have possibility to analyze the whole memory. So in the end, we are able to try to hunt interesting information in the memory. So it's not true that each individual exploit has got individual shellcode or ROP chain written for this specific exploit, because people are usually lazy, and if someone writes very reliable and flexible shellcode, the people will just reuse it and they'll copy across the other exploits. So we are able to have a database of known exploits attack, sorry, shellcodes or ROP gadgets, and we are able to hunt them in the memory. And in the past, it was very popular, for example, last stage of the Delirium group, shellcodes for the Windows. Almost in the 90% of the exploits, they were exactly using this one shellcode. So if we just do not analyze anything just to trying to find these specific shellcodes, we know that something bad is going on. And also, we are able to validate the structures and the pointers itself. This is also very interesting, especially when you're dealing with the heap manager, because we are able to check heap chunks itself, or heap headers, etc. But for me, what is also very interesting in modern exploitations, techniques, that we are able to see the and check the stack consistent about the return addresses. Because we have it in the full memory dump, we are able to rebuild the whole knowledge about what was the stack trace from the beginning up to the crash. And if we are able to analyze it from the back, we are able to see if at one point some of the address are not pointing to the ROP gadgets. So for example, stack pivoting technique has been done. If we detect it, again, it's done. It was attack. But of course, we can also validate local vector attacks. So if we know how to exploit, for example, Java or Flash, we know which kind of the structures in the Java are also used internally to overtake the control. So we are able to validate not only the global structures, but also the local one, specific for the application, but it requires the deep knowledge of the application. So if you come back for a minute to our previous analysis of the mini dump, and let's say we found this kind of interesting information. We found some interesting access violation, for example, on the right. We identified the MSRC case. We found known targeted application like Flash, Java, or browser. And we found some unusual values in the memory, in the registers, or reference the interesting memory addresses. And we also found in the memory shellcode and ROP gadgets. And also, we identified the corruption pointers, which are used to overtake the control. We just have exploit. It's 100% analyzed that we know this was crash generated exactly because of the exploits, because we identified everything which is necessary to write a correct exploit. But if you come back for a minute and rethink again this process, what will happen if we identify all of this information, but we didn't find the MSRC case for that specific function, neither for this specific version of the crashing application or model. But we found everything else. So we found the shellcode, we found corrupted pointers, we found targeted application, we found unusual values, we found access violation, but we just cannot find any information about exactly this, this model or function. We just found a zero day. And again, we've got 0 day for free, and now we are able to get it from the crash dump. And now we should report it to the Microsoft. Then we company will work very hard to deliver appropriate Windows update. And we'll thank you very much. So, but again, crash dumps and this presentation, this very basic presentation, it's not show everything, because world of the crash dump is not as beautiful. We always will have problem with some memory states. For example, it happened that we can see that there is some reference for the memory which could be page out. And in this case, we are in a very bad position, because if we see that some pointers, which is interesting for us, is pointing to the memory which was page out, but we cannot check it, what is going on there. In this case, it can give us extra hours of work, or even impossible to discover what was the real cause of the problem. Also, if the heap corruption was done, in most of the cases, we will have inconsistent heap state, so it's difficult to analyze the heap itself, what is going on. For example, there could be a corrupted list. But from the Windows side, if there was a corrupted list, there is a special crash dump generated, which caused fast fail crash. In this case, again, we know that if the list was corrupted in the heap, in most of the cases, it's not normal. And this type of crash also gives some evidence there's something bad going on. Also, in modern exploitation techniques, the memory spraying is done. And because of that, the state of the heap is very, very difficult to recover. So it's difficult to find what was the real root of the corruption. And also, because of the memory spraying, we'll be probably dealing with the false positives. And sometimes it's reference, some of the registers are referenced on the freed chunk in the memory. In this case, we just probably find two after free for free. But some of you probably may ask how often the real world exploits will fail and crash dump will be generated. Is it a real scenario? And to answer this question, we should analyze the exploitation trends. So again, is it real? I've got this plot. What is interesting about this plot, because it shows the exploitation trends over the time. What is interesting, for example, is this orange line. This is a typical old school attack of the stack return address overwrite. Because of the mitigation in the modern systems, we see this is significantly going down. Of course, it's still possible to exploit this old school vector of attack, but it's very difficult. So any time when we've got the more modern operation system, every time the exploits will fail and the crash dump will be generated. The same, for example, for the bypassing DEP. DEP is one of the mitigation in the memory safety. For the memory safety, attackers moved to use the .NET to bypass the DEP. Because we applied the new mitigation, again, we almost kill this vector of the attack. Each exploit, which will not know about that, so it will still using this vector of the attack. And we got the more modern system or the new mitigation, exploit will fail, the crash will be generated. And now if you imagine that we have the network with the thousands of the computers, each of the computer are able to have completely different, even the language version of the application. Even the language version change the structure, internal structure in the application. So because of that, even the different language will generate the crash for the exploits. Because nowadays, writing a very reliable exploit is almost impossible. It's very difficult to write. Of course, I found in my life some crazy exploit writer that one vulnerability has got inside 28 different payloads. But usually, it's not the case. Usually, it's someone just send a link to hundreds of the computers. More than half of them will just generate a crash. And what is also interesting, we see from the 2007, the heap sprint attack is going up. And 2011, we apply new modern mitigation. Again, this technique is going down. So we hope this also will be mitigated. Okay, so this was part of the exploits. Now we try to focus about the rootkits. So if we are able to find anything interesting about the rootkits in the crash dumps. So at first, we need to, in fact, summarize again shortly about the rootkits. What is a rootkit? What is the type of the rootkits in the modern world? So in the very high level, we can have user space rootkits and kernel space rootkits. User space rootkits are very easy to write, much more stable because they are getting a benefit from being a user space program. And they are, of course, because of that, very reliable and flexible. But also as a disadvantage is they are very easy to detect. They are usually many parts of the components which must be controlled over the system to achieve their goals. Usually update of any of this part of the system will just, it's critical for the rootkit. In the kernel space, it's quite much more interesting because we only modify one component of the system, which is the kernel itself. And they are, of course, much more powerful because usually only the imagination is a limit how to write these rootkits and what to do with there. And also some of the variants of the kernel rootkits are very extremely difficult to detect. Of course, everything has got also disadvantages, as well as the kernel rootkits, because they are very easy to break the system. They are not reliable and not flexible. Small mistakes can disturb the normal application, which are working in the user space or other components of the system. And bad design can cause some specific behavior. And this is funny because many people dealing with the kernel structures, which they do not really understand. And this usually happens with the blue screen of death in the Windows. And of course, they're much more difficult to write. And each kernel update, even the installing the service packs, is critical for the kernel rootkit. But rootkits, in the case of my talk, what is interesting is when the rootkits crashes, or if they crashes ever. So in the user space, rootkits, of course, they crashes. Sometimes they crashes because of the bugs in the code. And in fact, this is not the real. Uncommon situation. This is very real situation because modern rootkits writers they do not really want to spend much time about discovering what is going on in the system or what they should do and how do they write it. So they get sometimes very stupid bugs in the code. If there is a bug, they just crash. The same with the user space application changes because user space rootkits they usually hook some user space program. Is the program change again crash? If the structure change, again, crash. If they are relies on the undocumented API, most of them they do, again, crash. Most of the time, these 3 points happen after upgrade. About the kernel space, same situation. There is bugs in the code. It's a very real situation. I met a lot of rootkits who generate the blue screen of that because just stupid bugs in the code was implemented. Also, if someone poor understand the kernel which they are playing, again, it will generate the crash. If the structure has changed, crash. If the service symbol, table changed the numbers, crash. If there is a different target than expected, crash. If there is a kernel protection like patch guard, crash. So in fact, it happens very often, especially in the modern Windows, because patch guard killed, from our statistics, more than 75% of the previous rootkits which was written. And again, usually this happens the 4 last points after upgrade. And again, we'll have the memory state problems if you analyze the kernel crash dumps. Again, if the memory for the kernel rootkits which was used was in the page pool memory, not in the non-page pool memory, this page can be page out. And this is the real world example from the rootkit which I was analyzing. There was some memory which was referenced in the PTE 40,000. It was in the transition state. When I was looking closer, I saw that there is a bit modified enabled, which means that this exactly page was dirty, which means there was some real data, which was probably very interesting for me, but I cannot do nothing with that because it was just page out. So my analysis was finished. Other problems which we'll be dealing, it will be corrupted internal structures in the kernel. And also, sometimes it happens that they are reference of the freed memory chunks. Usually it happens because of the bugs in the rootkits. Again, real world example, which I was analyzing one of the rootkits, they register their objects under this namespace. But for some reason, when I was looking it closer, they were not able to, kernel was not able to get information about this object. So I was looking closer what is going on, and I discovered that this exactly director object was allocated in the freed memory. Again, probably user saw blue screen of that, and to blame Microsoft for that, but it was just the rootkit activity, which was very badly written. So, okay, now there is a question What kind of information in the crash dumps, in the kernel crash dumps, we should try to hunt to identify if the crash was happened because of the bugs in the code or because the crash was generated of the rootkit activities. So in the standard kernel crash dump file, we'll have this type of information. We'll have list of the modules, list of the drivers. We are able to enumerate all of the kernel objects if the crash dumps, of course, allows that. We enumerate all of the process and threads also. If, of course, crash dumps keeps this information, depends which type of crash dump you have. The same, we are able to validate service table and all connected structures like shadow service table or argument service table, etc. In fact, we can verify everything, of course, if crash dumps allows us to do it. So if you look closer at first for information marked on this red circle, how can we validate that? How can we validate what is good, what is not? So in fact, we need to use our Windows kernel knowledge we should have. So we know, for example, if there is object of which is a type of the object, which is a driver, people who play with the kernel, they know that the driver should be registered in the specific location in the kernel. So if we, for example, discover that some of the driver are not in the valid structure or not registered where it should be or registered only in some of them, in other structures that are not registered, in most of the cases, this driver just tried to hide himself in the kernel. The same with the object, with the processes. So if you have a process which wants to be hidden because of the rootkit, it will not be registered in all of the places where it should be. Again, we can able to just validate all of the structures, all of the lists, and see where it's registered, where it's not. If it's not registered where it should be, it's hidden. But how can we validate, for example, the system service table? And again, we have benefits from Microsoft, which is a public symbols. We can trust the public symbols because they are in the Microsoft externally, so nobody modifies it. So we can able to check if the service table in the crash dumps is exactly the same, that keeps exactly the same value, which the public symbol says us. So if the offset are the same or not. So we just validate them, compare. Offset's the same, it's okay. Offset's not the same, someone just hook some of the function in the service table. And in fact, we can verify everything with the public symbols, even the whole kernel image itself. So if someone modified the kernel, we can just verify it with the public symbols. So if we didn't able to find all of the registers, structures for the drivers which we found on the process was not registered where it should be, and some public symbols not match exactly what is the kernel structures, in most of the cases, this is just a rootkit activity. But again, question is, if it's always like that. And now it's trying to, now it's coming the difficult part, because in modern world, many legal, let's say, program, they doing rootkit-like activities. For example, antiviruses, especially in the 32 bits, they was modifying the service table by themselves because they want to secure the Windows, so they just was doing exactly the same what the rootkit does. So they're just hooking some of the stuff. Again, if you detect it from the previous analysis, in fact, we'll detect that something bad is going on, but this is something which we want to have, because we want to have antivirus. So in fact, this is a false positive. The same, there is some drivers who just filter other drivers, and they modify on the fly their data. Again, it's rootkit kind of activity, but this driver is legal. One of the examples is daemon tools. If you have installed daemon tools, half of the activity of this driver, it's just works like rootkit, but we want to have it. So it's a, let's say, legal rootkit, yes? So how we can solve this problem if you analyze it? The answer is, in fact, simple. We just create the signature list when we keep all of the information. So if you found some hook and we check if the hook was done by antivirus, we can have in the signature that this antivirus is hooking exactly that. So we just ignore it. How about the practice? So I have the movie, I will show it later. I hope you'll have time. And so the question is how to collect the data. So because all of this analysis makes sense if you have the crash dumps. So the question is how to collect them, especially in the large networks. So in the Windows, we've got something which calls Windows Error Reporting Protocol. I hope probably some of you know, which calls a VER. But also there is something which not many people are familiar, which calls a SER, which is a Corporate Error Reporting Protocol. In the very high level, this image shows how it works in both cases. So whenever you've got some crash dumps, probably you see this kind of pop-up which saying that Some application crashes, do you want to send some information to the Microsoft for better support, blah, blah, blah. So if you click yes and you do send, what happened? Windows over the VER protocol, so Windows Error Reporting, will connect to our internal database, we called it Collector, which calls Watson, and these small crash dumps will be sent to us. If you enable the corporate error reporting protocol, all of the crash dumps can be configured to start in the specific location or in the specific directory. It can be run over the network, over SMB, etc. And then we are able also to set up our own collector in our own network. In this case, all of the crash dumps, if the corporate error reporting is enabled, will be stored in the specific location and then will be sent to our collector. And we can just store all of the crash dumps per day. So the goal is, if you set up your own collector, you are also able to configure this collector to optionally send also this information to us. But this is optional, it depends on you. So the goal is how to enable the corporate error reporting. It's very easy because you just edit the group policy in the Windows, and under Windows Error Reporting section, you just put the location of the folder when you want to store the crash dumps, and you put IP address and port where is your own collector listening. That's all. So I want to show you some statistics, which I've done in this specific time slot, 1st of the January 2012, up to 1st of the April 2013. So I will be discussing only about in the statistics about software which is written by Microsoft. So I will not include in the statistics any software about other third-party vendors like Adobe Reader or etc. This is only what Microsoft develops. We found, using exactly this telemetry, 1,550 known exploits, and it's confirmed exploits for Internet Explorer. For any other software which Microsoft is vendor, it's only 13. So if you compare in the chart, yeah, it's quite a big vector of attack. So that's the reason Microsoft is very careful about Internet Explorer itself and puts a lot of resources to monitor it. If you look closer, only for IE cases, for IE exploits, then we see that 1,454 exploits was written for one specific vulnerability. It was CVE-2012-1889. 94 exploits was written for 4969, three exploits for 1876, and only one exploit for 1856. So if you compare on the chart, it looks quite funny. So in fact, this was the real exploits which we found and confirmed, and we have it. And now I want to show you that this kernel analyzing, it really works, it's not just a theory, because I know it sounds quite difficult. So I'm owner of one of the projects, which I written for quite a long time. I don't know if you will see here something. It's not awesome. Let me find. Okay. Still don't see quite good, but okay, maybe you will see something. So there is a program as an input. You put the cap file, which is just a crash dump. You just put the signature file, which I keep in XML, and an output also generate me XML. So in this program, it just keeps running, and in the end, okay, it's quite difficult now to see what is going on. Okay. It will work more or less 5 minutes for each crash dump. So you see trying to reference some of the memory which is paged out so you cannot access it. So this monitoring, it just prints you what is going on. So there is another object which he detects under different namespace. So he's just trying to discover all of the information which I was talking before automatically. Yeah, and in the end he finished it. So what is the output for this analyzing? This was crash dumps. Where was real rootkit activity? Let me show you. Yeah, this is the output. So you see, this is a signature file. He found, for example, here daemon tools, which I keep as a signature. He found the drivers, Intel drivers, who also do hooking in his rootkit-like activities. But it also found signature which is written for the rootkit itself. So there is a probably some infected rootkit. So if we go closer, we see here a hidden model, for example. So we found that this specific crash dumps has got inside hidden models. And there is more objects which are hidden. So I keep in the XML value hidden, and it shows everything what is unknown and hidden. So you see that this specific model imports some strange function, and in fact, it looks like a Windows kernel image itself. What happened that in fact this specific rootkit, he was importing the kernel from the drive. You see there is even the name, which calls here, this is the name of the kernel, normal kernel. He was importing on the fly, modifying the kernel, some structures, and then he redirect the flow for this new kernel, which was loaded. So just because analyzing crash dumps, I can discover what is going on. What I also found in this report by this program, and you will see, yeah, this is also hidden object. But what is interesting, look for the, is it here or not yet? Yeah, look for the name with the Chinese characters. It's uncommon that legal drivers or legal module register objects with the Chinese characters on the namespace. Obviously something going on there. And you see like hundreds of the objects which are hidden. So in the 100%, this is just a rootkit activity. And you are able to extract this in fact rootkit from the crash dump. Yeah, this is in fact quite long movie because I thought I would have more time and go in the details for everything. So this is another hook which in fact are in the IRP, and I believe it was done by daemon tools even. Okay. This is another hook. Another hook. This is SSDT table, which was hooked. Yeah, it was quite interesting because what also found this project, if you look here, there is even the path when the rootkit developer was creating own project, and there is path where he saved his project when the rootkit on his local drive was exactly written here. And also we can see that there is a there is, of course, it's written by signature, but also you see there is a generated symbols for this module. Okay. So now, if you have question, I'm open for answer everything.
How can we check if the MSRC case is submitted for the certain crash dump?
You've got MSRC bulletin, and you just go to the Microsoft website and trying to poke about, trying to find all of the cases, public MSRC bulletin for this specific function. In most of the cases, Microsoft has got also the partner programs, so you are able to cooperate with the Microsoft, and he will one time per month send you all of the database, and you'll have it.
Okay. Have I understood it correctly? If my Windows crashes, then the crash dump will eventually be sent to you over the WIR?
Normally, it's not sent. It depends on you. If you want to send it, you click yes, and then it will be sent to us.
Let's say I want to send it to you, and I want to have it analyzed. Will I get any feedback in case my Windows is somehow affected by a rootkit? So I know that I must reinstall it or so.
To be honest, it's impossible to do because we are not able to keep private information about the computer. So if you send even the crash dump to the Microsoft, we have no idea who sent it. We have no idea which computer generated it. We just have a crash dump. So we have no idea where it comes from because we cannot keep this information. This is private information. And I believe if we'll be doing it, we'll get a lot of blame of that.
Hey, two questions. So first question is, the tool that you've shown, will it be public or open sourced even? And the second question is, how many crashes do you get from antiviruses?
Hi, Jin, by the way. So first question, no, this in fact tool is private one. I believe it never be public because this is part of the bigger project, which is because of that it will never be public. And this tool is written for the crash dumps. We also have a similar project for the user space dump file because I'm only working on the kernel space. About the second part of the question, may you repeat?
Yes, so how many crashes are caused by faulty antivirus modules?
To be honest, it's more than I expected. Especially famous was, which we discussed in fact yesterday, the antivirus from the Brazil. So in the Brazil, there is one vendor who is very popular, and because of the Windows update, half of the Brazil generated crashes on the Windows system. Everyone told because of our update was bad. But because of that, we're starting to analyze exactly this specific situation, and we discovered that antivirus was doing very nasty hooking, so he hard-coded offset in the structure, because there was exactly vulnerability in this function, so we patched this structure, offset was changed, and half of the Brazil went down. So it wasn't our fault, but we also need to delete. So in the end, I discovered that, in fact, most of the cases nowadays is not generated by the antivirus. This was a case for the mostly 32 bits, because in the 64 bits Windows, we published the API that we register a callbox, and now the most modern antivirus just register in the legal callbox when it should do. But for the 32 bits, it was much more often. But what we see also, there is the biggest generator of the crash dumps is done by the third-party vendors, because they write the drivers which are, their codes are very dirty. And most of the crashes which we see is generated exactly by the third-party drivers. And because of that, we also have a partner program, that if you are a vendor for the third-party driver, you are able to sign with us a contract and we'll give you an access to the crash dumps for your specific driver that you can see where is a bug and you are able to get these crash dumps analyzed by yourself just for better support. Mówię jak jest.
I would like to ask you, do you have any specific methods or heuristics to actually detect the situation when crash is caused by, for example, hardware problem? Because I, in my opinion, most of, maybe I'm wrong, but probably most crashes comes from broken hardware.
It's also connected with the general question because, as I said, most of the crashes in fact generated by the drivers, yes, so it's somehow connected with the hardware. But again, the problem itself, it's a software anyway, it's not the hardware, because the software for specific hardware is written in most of the cases in a very nasty way, and they are dirty, in fact, codes, because we are not able to validate everything, we're trying to do it, but the biggest problem is just the software, driver software.
Okay, if there is no other question, thank you very much for your speech,
Adam.
Thank you
very much.